And my friend who knows that sometimes I can't always remember the words, so she helps me. Good morning. Aren't you glad to be alive and a Christian today? Aren't you glad to know the Savior, that your sins are covered by the blood of Jesus Christ? He's life-changing, isn't he? All-giving, my supplier and my friend. And I'm so glad to call him my friend today. Jesus Christ, the day he saved my soul, truly the windows of heaven did open.
The windows of heaven are open. The blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my soul since Jesus made everything right. I gave him my old tattered garments. He gave me a robe of pure white. I'm feasting on honey from Canaan, and that's why
see our hopes all realized, I could not help but think of Regina and Brother Johnny as they walked through that gate, walked and ran when they couldn't hear on this earth. But I tell you, the promise that we have should excite us every day of our lives, because we have a hope, that hope of glory, that no matter what befalls us here, we truly are, as we're getting ready to sing, sheltered in the arms of God. From darkness into light is what He takes us. From fear into peace. He gives that liberally. So if you suffer today, if your heart is burdened down with care, there is no reason for that. You are in God's sanctuary this morning, where hope and help can be found. Peace for your soul. We're going to sing Sheltered in the Arms of God. And I say, glory, He's worthy today.
But I have no fear for Jesus. without further ado, without any more singing, God's in this place, and if you need to talk to Him, now's your chance. Slip out of your chair. Come and join these that kneel at the altar. If you have a praise or a petition, several of our people are battling cancer. Several have lost loved ones. Some are struggling on their job. Some are struggling with their children, with their grandchildren. Let's make it a matter of prayer this morning. Issues that we can't handle. Problems that we can't solve. Let's tell them to Jesus. Lord's here this morning, and we would do nothing to grieve or quench His presence. This is why we come to church. Heavenly Father, we thank You this morning that we can come that we're still able to sense Your presence and the drawing of Your Holy Spirit to our heads and to our hearts. Lord, the things that we face are too big for us. But there's nothing too big for You. There is nothing that can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So as we come and praise You this morning and thank You for who You are, bless the Lord, O my soul. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, God the great three in one. Those that are suffering, those that are struggling, those, dear Lord, that the devil's just beating over the head. Father, we pray that You would be with each and every request, each and every prayer this morning. Intercede. Touch, heal, give grace, give strength, give wisdom, give understanding. Make us more like You. Mold us and make us after Your will while we kneel at this altar, yielded and still. Help us to be still. Know that You're God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Blessed we are in this congregation to feel the presence of the Lord, and to have His anointing, to comfort, to uplift.
Standing still, it's hard to do. So many times we run ahead or lag behind. And the Lord told Moses, Moses, I don't want the children to go backward. I don't want them to go forward. Just tell them to stand still and let me move. Usher's coming this time, and we'll receive our Sunday morning tithes and offerings. Brother Delmas, you want to pray for us?
When I was trying to figure out what I was going to sing this morning, all I could think about was Johnny Parsons, so I dedicate this to him. I once heard a story of a sainted old brother who had lived out his life here on earth. As he lay on his deathbed, his friends gathered round him. These were the last words he said. Oh, look what I'm leaving behind. Oh, look who will be there to greet me when I step in God's sweet paradise. I'm leaving behind all my sorrow. I'm leaving behind all my cares. For I've traded it all for a mansion that Jesus has gone to prepare. His hands were so feeble, his voice was so low, but he still had a smile on his face. How true that was, right? He said, I hear singing. Oh, they're waiting for me. And then he looked up to heaven and said, oh, look what I've traded for a mansion. Oh, look what I'm leaving behind. Oh, there to greet me when I step in God's sweet paradise. Well, I'm leaving behind all my sorrow, and I'm leaving behind all my cares, for I've traded it all for a mansion that Jesus has gone to prepare. Yes, I've traded it all for a mansion that Jesus has gone to prepare.
I need no mansion here below, for Jesus said that I could go to a home beyond the clouds, not made with hands. Won't you come and go along? Help me to sing heaven and earth's sweetest song that's ever been played upon the harps in Glory Land. Please don't forget the announcements that were made earlier. Sunday school board meeting at 5 o'clock, choir practice at 5 o'clock, church service at 6, and then Wednesday evening, I believe we're having a dinner before prayer meeting, church board meeting Tuesday night, Sunday, service Sunday morning, and then Sunday afternoon, 2 o'clock, will be a memorial for Brother John Parsons. There will be no Sunday evening service next Sunday evening, so please take note of that. That'll be a time of fellowship together. I have two words that I want you to think about this morning. In fact, I'm going to ask you to do them. They're very difficult. Most people choose not to do them. That's why we're in the mess we're in this world. Most people won't do what these two words direct. I can ask you to do them because Jesus did. He asked his disciples and anyone that wanted to be a Christian to do these things. Many of them didn't get what he was asking. Went right over their head. others that understood. Said this is a very hard thing. And so as they thought about what he was asking, they turned and decided to walk with him no more. A young man that wanted desperately to know the way to heaven, how to get there, and to be sure he was going, came running to Jesus and asked him, "Good master, what must I do to have eternal life?" People are asking that question over and over and over again. When Jesus told him, he didn't like what he heard. And he dropped his head and turned and went away from Christ. If you ever buy your Bibles, turn to the book of Matthew, the 16th chapter, verses 24 through 27. And as you're turning there, you'll notice it's red letter edition, signifying to me and you its importance as being the words of Jesus. Matthew 16, 24 through 27. Stand with me for just a moment while we read a portion of God's holy word. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and he shall reward every man according to his works." Heavenly Father, help us this morning to put a searchlight on our soul and examine ourselves. We are so good in this age, we've almost mastered examining other people. But this morning, let us examine no one but ourselves. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The two words: deny yourself. Deny yourself. Many people in this day and age want nothing to do with the Holiness Church because it demands that a person deny themselves. The Holiness Church reveals that Jesus taught it and he stood for it. In many of our Holiness churches, sad to say, from the platform in the pulpit, it is no longer being preached that a person must deny themselves in order to get to heaven. Every sin and all selfishness, Satan sends our way. And every sin and selfishness, Satan is behind. And Jesus is teaching in these scriptures, as he does in John, in order for a person to enter the kingdom of God, they must be born again. They must be changed. They must become different. The conversion experience molds them and makes them a new creature in Christ Jesus. The only place I know that you can have it your way is at Burger King. You can't even have it your way at home. Now, I've had husbands lie to me before and tell me that their wife does whatever they say and they have it their way at home. But not in one case was their wife present when they made that statement. That was for a reason. Jesus said, if you want to be a Christian, if you want to follow me, you must willfully and voluntarily, he's not going to make you do it, deny yourself. There's three things that are involved in the art of self-denial. The first one is you get a new purpose. See, before you are converted and saved, your purpose is not to come to church. It's not to serve God. You know what your purpose is? To do anything you want to do. And so people get caught up in sports and entertainment and making money and getting a good job and all kinds of material and worldly and earthly things. But I would hate to think that God brought me into this world just for earthly things. I had a friend of mine that was an X-ray technician. Him and his wife got involved in selling all kinds of cologne and perfumes and cosmetics. And he started making money. They bought a franchise. They were successful. Her little girl said, my mommy's going to be a millionaire. He quit his job at the hospital as an X-ray technician, went into that field to help her. And that business failed. Both of those franchises went bankrupt. And they lost everything. And as I was talking to my brother, he said, "You know, Phil, I'd hate to think that God placed me in this world just to sell lipstick and cologne. God has a purpose for you and me. Do you know what your purpose is? Are you fulfilling God's purpose for your life?" The apostle Paul said when he was converted, "It's no longer I, but Christ lives in me. He's controlling me." Is Christ your purpose in life? My brother said, "You know, no matter where I go, I try to slip in a few words for Jesus in the church, hoping and praying that some of them will sink." A new purpose. Here it is. "Lord, not my will, but thine be done." Amen. Have you come to the place in your personal life that you've not only prayed that prayer, but you mean it, and you seek the will of God every day for your life? Let me ask you, do you think it's God's will for you to come to Sunday school? Why don't some of you come? Do you think it's God's will for you to be in Sunday morning worship service and avail yourself of the singing and the preaching? Do you think it's God's will when these little circular plates are passed, we call them the offering plate, would you think it would be God's will for you to give Him 10% of your income because it's His? It belongs to Him. He's loaned it to you to see if you'll give it back to Him. Do you think it might be God's will for you even to come back on Sunday evening worship? Now, the preachers that have done away with it, you've got it made. You don't have to worry about that. But we still have church here. You know why? Because we need it. We need it. With the way the world is and the struggles within the church, we need the Word of God appropriated and applied to our life. Deny self. Bauer's translation of that is, you've got to die to self. As long as self is in control, you won't live right. You'll live selfishly. Christ will never be Lord of your life until you die to self. What causes a person to become jealous? What works on a person's emotions to be envious or to become angry or to be bitter with an individual? You may say, preacher, that's sin. It is, but that's not the cause of it. Selfishness. Selfishness is the root cause of negative emotions. And that's why Jesus said, if you're going to be a Christian, you're going to have to make some adjustments and take up your cross. Take up your cross and follow me. Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No. There's a cross for every one of his children. And there's a cross for you and for me. Now they say that you shouldn't preach on that on Sunday morning. And you shouldn't mention that on Sunday morning. You'll offend people. You'll run people away. Well, I've been doing that for 45 years. There ain't no sense in quitting now. Somebody told me, preacher, not long ago, just a week or so ago, there's going to be people leave our church if you continue to take the stands you're taking. You know what I told them? I'm mean. You got a mean pastor. I said, let them leave. If they leave because of the hole in the stand, they'll have to leave and we'll have to get over it. Amen? Amen. Deny yourself. Those that will lose their life will find it. And those that will try to save their life, the same shall lose it. Our churches are losing on every hand due to selfishness. Now, others won't preach it, but I will. God never has, never will bless a selfish individual. Come and follow me, Jesus said. He said, no man takes my life from me. I freely lay it down in order to pick it up and take it again. We've got to have a new purpose. And number two, we've got to have a new perspective. We've got to see different. We've got to look different. You know, before you're saved, you can't see it. Man, you can't see the church getting 10% of your money. You can't see going to a church where all that preacher talks about is money. You don't agree with that. You can't see it. And in order to be a Christian, old things have to pass away. And all things become new. And there's a change in you. When the Holy Spirit comes in, you become a new creature in Christ Jesus. And the things that you didn't want to do, now you want to. The things that you love to do. You don't love to do those things anymore. You know, I'm old. And I tell Brenda every day, Brenda, we're getting old. And I said, for the life of me, I can't keep up with this younger generation. They want to get saved and continue to smoke and casually drink and gamble and fool with the world. Where's that in the Bible? The Bible says just the opposite. That when you get saved, you don't love the world anymore. Or the things of the world. And if anybody does, they're not of the Father, but they're of the world. You know, sometimes I just wish we'd preach it and teach it just like it is. That's why I come here to church. I know I'm going to get the whole truth, nothing but the truth. So help me God. And the reason I know that is I'm preaching it. But you get a new perspective on things. The apostle said, I see things differently. There's been a change in me. Has there been a change in you? Is it evident? Is it so much different that people wonder or even ask, what's happened to you? I had a guy in my church that worked on the river. Those guys were mean and filthy mouthed and stole everything that wasn't locked down. And he got saved one Sunday morning in the Sunday morning service. And he came to me and he said, Pastor Bauer, I go back to the boat Monday morning. He said, would you pray for me that I wouldn't lose my job? I said, I sure will. What makes you think that you'll lose your job? He said, I'll be carrying two or three duffel bags worth of equipment that I've stole off of that boat. And I know that's not right. And I know that, now this is a guy that got saved on Sunday morning. And I know the Lord wants me to make restitution for that. What's keeping you from doing that? And so I said, Bob, what time you go to work? And he told me. I said, I'll be praying for you Monday morning. When he came home on leave, I said, well, now, Bob, tell me, did you lose your job? And he started crying. And he said, no. He said, the captain was out there watching us board. And he saw me dragging these three duffel bags full of stuff onto the plank. And he said, Bob, what's these? He said, these are things that I've taken off of this boat. I've borrowed them and now I'm bringing them back. And the captain looked at him and said, what happened to you? Did you get saved or something? And come to find out that that captain's grandma was an old holiness shouter. And even though he didn't serve God, she had pumped enough religion into him that allowed him to know that when you become a Christian, you have a new purpose and you have a new perspective. You don't see how close to the world and its habits you can get. When you have old-time Holy Ghost, heartfelt, sin-killing, devil-defeating, bought by the blood and baptized in the Holy Ghost religion, you see how far away that you can get. And last of all, but not least, if you're going to deny yourself, you're going to understand that God has a new plan for your life. It's not your plan. It's His. You see, before we're saved, we're not interested in His plan. The only plan you're interested in is the plan you have for you. As the song leader and musicians come, the self-made plan must die. Do you hear me? The self-made plan must die. God's plan's a lot better. He calls it a new and living way. He reveals a little bit of His plan. He said, now that gate's pretty straight. Do you remember when it used to be? Well, you couldn't enter the Holiness Church without hearing a Holiness message. If you didn't want the preacher to mention hell or judgment, you better go somewhere else to church. Because they told it just like it was. So that if people were going to be saints instead of sinners, they'd come through the straight gate. And He said, His plan, narrow is the way, but it leads to life everlasting. I close this morning, but never, never in a million years would I have ever guessed the plan of God for my life. If someone would have told me when I was 16 or 17 and dating Brenda, Phil, one day, you're going to be called to preach. And you're going to stand before a congregation in West Virginia. And you're going to preach my gospel. I just said, say what? God's got a plan for your life. Don't miss it because you won't improve on it. It'll be a plan just for you. A new purpose, a new perspective, and a new plan. Shall we stand? Sing. Softly and tenderly. Lord, I need that for my life. That's what I need. See you on the portals. I need a new purpose. I get up in the morning, I go to work, I come home, I eat dinner, I rest a while, I go to bed. Next day I get up and do the same thing. What's your purpose? What's your perspective? What's God's plan for your life? Is He calling you? We're going to sing another verse. If you don't know His purpose, if you don't have His perspective, His outlook, if you don't know His plan, just before we close, all the people that are searching, the people that are seeking for purpose, perspective, for God's plan. I wonder if I could ask each and every one of you individually, do you know God's purpose for your life? Are you living God's purpose? And about that new perspective, I fear that even in the church, when things arise, we don't look at them the way He looks at them. As to His purpose for this church and for our individual lives, you see, it's not up to us. In fact, it's not even about us. It's about Him. Heavenly Father, help us this Sunday morning. Those that kneel here at an altar prayer, as they pray, be with them. Help them answer their prayers. And then as we leave this place, help us to examine our purpose, our perspective, and the plan of God for our lives. For we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Shake hands with everyone. You folks that are praying, just keep praying.